Good morning, friends. Today we will be talking about a basic classification of life forms. This should have been the first chapter in biodiversity, but generally I do not teach it in class. I request students to study these things at their own, but this time since many of you had requested ki please cover even this section in the classroom, I'm doing it. So here I have ensured that even the NCERT basic section on classification of various life forms is properly being covered. I have only included those things here which may be relevant for your preliminary examination. I am not getting into depth of biology or depth of classification, and I'm not going to explain those things or cover those things which are very technical and which the chances of which being asked in examination is very, very, very less. Okay, the only broader understanding of how life on earth has been classified would be covered here. Today, like for those of you who are joining late, today I'm not carrying my earphones, so I'll not be able to hear you. All your doubts should come from chats, in the form of through chats only. Now, when we talk about various life forms on earth, when we look around us, we see different species, different genus, different family, different phylums. We see mosquitoes, we see dogs, we see human beings, we see plants. How are they classified, or how are they related to each other? Today our focus is on understanding this. Now see, initially, when someone is asked, let us classify all the living forms on earth. So one of the first classification was done by Aristotle, who said that this life form can be divided into the ones living on land and the ones living in water. But that was a wrong classification. It was just randomly things were classified. The classification that we are talking about, the classification that we are discussing, the classification that is used today of various life form, it is related to evolution. So basically, understand this. Let's say this is a living organism. This is a living organism. And from this living organism, two more organisms evolve. They'll be related to each other. They'll be connected. There would be a lot of similarities. Some genes may have modified, but there would be a lot of similarities. Similarly, if other living organisms emerge from these, they would be related. The difference between this and this would be very less when compared to difference between this or this. So the classification of life forms that we would be talking about, it would be how living organisms have evolved and what kind of similarities there are. For example, in the very first class of biodiversity, we spoke about critically endangered mammals. So mammals are one of the vertebrates, and mammals have some characteristics. Mammals would have mammary glands through which they will nurse their children. Mammals will give birth to living children. Mammals will have four chambered hearts. Mammals will have body hairs. A dog is also a mammal. I'm also a mammal, and all these similarities are there because in the process of evolution, we somehow are connected. Idhar se evolution hoke dog species may have come, idhar se evolution, this path of evolution se human beings may have come into play. So this classification and evolution is very much connected, that you should remember. And the classification that we would be talking about would be based on this. Now, all the living organisms on earth are classified into various kingdoms. All the living organisms on earth are classified into various kingdoms. The most standard way of doing this classification is dividing the living organisms into 5 different kingdoms: Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, Animalia. These are the 5 kingdoms which were given by Robert Whittaker. Monera basically is covering the prokaryotic species. You remember eukaryotic, prokaryotic we had covered in science. Prokaryotic species were those species which had a single cell, and more importantly, single cell to zaruri wo hai, but it will not have membrane bound organelles. It will not have membrane bound organelles. So prokaryotic living beings are there in the first Monera. So most of the bacterias would be here. Bacterias are generally prokaryotic. They do not have organelles. Well, they will not have a mitochondria, they will not have a nucleus. All the function would be done by things available in cytoplasm, just like that. We'll get into the details of Monera. Protista is basically a hodgepodge kingdom. Hodgepodge kingdom, the species which we are not able to fit in, fungi, plantae, animalia, and are eukaryotic. I hope you all of you understand the difference between prokaryotic and eukaryotic. We have already covered it in the science and tech section. जब हम सेल्स के बारे में पढ़ रहे थे, we have already covered. तो species which are eukaryotic but cannot fit in this category, fungi, plantae, animalia, goes in protista. So a very good example of protista, a very common example of protista is a plasmodium which causes malaria. If you remember, malaria is not a bacterial disease, malaria is not a viral disease, malaria is caused by plasmodium which comes into this kingdom. We'll talk about these kingdoms in more detail, but here just get a broader understanding. Monera mein we are having mostly all the prokaryotic species. We know all prokaryotic species are single celled. Prokaryotes do not form multiple, they are very preliminary primary species, they are single cell. In Protista we have mostly single cell eukaryotes, eukaryotic species which are single cell. Some of them, for example algae can come in plants also, it can come in Protista also, can be multicellular, but in Protista most of the single cell eukaryotic. So Monera mein we have single cell prokaryotic, Protista mein single cell eukaryotic. For example, amoeba, all of us draw amoeba in our class 9 or class 10 syllabus. We draw a single cell, but if you remember, you also draw organelles inside the cell. It's a eukaryotic species, but a single cell species. It will go into Protista. Then fungi are eukaryotic species which are an important characteristic here is they depend on dead organic material for their food. We'll look at more details. Then plant kingdom, animal kingdom, anyways we'll be discussing it in detail. We come in animal kingdom. Now animal kingdom may be there are lots of division. For example, we'll have vertebrates and invertebrates. Vertebrates would be those species which have backbone, the skeleton structure which is giving me a shape. Vertebrates, we have already studied, this can be divided into mammals, can be divided into fish, birds, reptiles, amphibians. So in biodiversity, we looked at critically endangered species of these things. Whereas when we were talking about butterfly, butterfly doesn't have a backbone. Butterfly was invertebrate. Invertebrate may be, there are various further classifications. There are various further classifications. Unme se ek arthropod hoga, usme se ek, one of them would be arthropod, and of that we'll have insects, there we'll have butterfly. So I hope you're able to understand this classification. We will in today's class, we will cover this in greater detail. So first, all the living organisms on earth can be divided into these five kingdoms. Here by living organism, I mean cellular living organisms, living organism which have cells. Virus do not have cell. So we are not fitting in virus here anywhere. This I hope is understood. Let me see. There are no doubts yet. Okay. Now, recently in 2015, the number of kingdoms were expanded to 7. A new classification has come. Not very popular yet. Most of the books are still mentioning the five kingdom wala thing. That's why our focus of study would be on five kingdom wala thing. But recently we have the 7 kingdom system where Monera has been divided into 2 kingdoms. Ek to Monera hai, ya bacteria bol lo, aur dusra Archaea. Monera or bacteria, and second is Archaea. Similarly, this thing, Protista, has also been divided into Protista and Chromista. So 7 kingdoms, as per the latest classification, new method of classification, there are 7 kingdoms. But we'll study the classification on the basis of 5 kingdoms only. Further, this classification, this whole classification, here 2 more two classification, here 2. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. These 7 kingdoms have been further classified broadly into domains or super kingdoms. Those domains are wo prokaryote and eukaryote wala. So these would go in, these 2 kingdoms would go in prokaryotes, or Monera would go in prokaryotes, and these are eukaryotes. Prokaryote and eukaryote classification is kingdom se bhi upar wala classification, that is super kingdom level classification, or it's also called domain. So all the living organisms on earth can be divided into prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Sabse pehla classification, super kingdoms, prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Then in prokaryotes we have Protista, or now Protista and Archaea. I'm sorry, Monera. I'm sorry, maine galat bol diya. In prokaryotes we have Monera, or in the newer classification, jo 2015 mein naya classification aaya hai, Monera and Archaea. Then in the eukaryotic domain or eukaryotic super kingdom, we have all these Protista, fungi, plantae, animalia. Protista can Protista ki jagah ab we use Protista and Chromista. Okay, basic class 9, class 10 biology classification, all of us may have studied this during our class 9, class 10. It might, and when I was in class 9, this was taught to me in class 9, not in class 10. Okay, I hope this is understood, this broad classification is understood to you. Now We'll study about the difference between Monera and Archaea in a bit. We'll also talk about Protista and Chromista in some time. Give me some time. But for in 1990, Karl Wuss had divided all the kingdom into all the life species into three domains. So what he had done, जो प्रोकैरियोट्स थे, प्रोकैरियोट्स को इन्होंने अलग अलग डोमेन में रखा. प्रोकैरियोट्स वर बैक्टीरिया एंड आर्किया. सो बेसिकली टू सुपर किंगडम्स दैट वी हैव स्टडीड, प्रोकैरियोट्स एंड यूकैरियोट्स. ही सेज दैट प्रोकैरियोट्स कैन आल्सो बी टू सेपरेट, प्रोकैरियोट्स कैन बी टू सेपरेट डोमेन, बैक्टीरिया एंड आर्किया. तो दीज आर प्रोकैरियोट्स एंड हियर वी हैव यूकैरियोट्स. सो बेसिकली व्हाट वी आर सेइंग, ऑल द लाइफ on earth, all the life on earth can be divided into domains or super kingdom, prokaryotes and eukaryotes, simple. And then each of those prokaryotes will have kingdoms. They say we are in animal kingdom. Under that kingdom will have phylum, then class, then order, family, genus, species. At lowest level we have species. For example, we are Homo sapiens. Our species is that of Homo sapiens. Okay, so we'll study more about Archaea, but pehle isko thoda sa aur samajh lete hain. Let's come here. Kingdoms would have many phylums or divisions. Within one kingdom, we'll have many phylums or divisions. Within a phylum will have many class, within class will have order, order ke andar family, family ke andar genus, genus ke andar. Living organisms, if they are part of the same species, then they are so similar. Genetically there may be slight differences, jaise hamare beech mein bhi, between us and people living in Europe there are slight genetical differences, but still we are of the same gene. We are of the same species. So why are we considered of the same species? Generally, when we are of the same species, we can mate together to reproduce. That is one important thing that you should remember about this this aspect. For example, now if you come to humans, you'll see humans ka kingdom Animalia hai. But in Animalia, in this kingdom, in this big kingdom of Animalia, we have insects, we have lizards, we have reptiles, we have bacteria. Not bacteria, I'm sorry, butterflies. We have mosquito. All those things are part of Animalia. Within Animalia, there are many phylum. The phylum to which we belong is Chordata. It is the mammal wala phylum. It is, sorry, vertebrates wala phylum. Mammal to aur niche aayega. It is the vertebrate wala phylum. So in the animal kingdom, if you let me draw a big animal kingdom, you'll have humans, but animal, hum humans, dogs, buffaloes, insects, mollusk, fish, birds, everything is part of this animal kingdom. Within the animal kingdom there are phylums, and the phylum to which we belong is Chordata. Chordata is wo backbone wala phylum, spinal cord wala phylum. So here again, even in this, we are clubbed together with birds, with fish, with amphibians, with reptiles. We are clubbed with them. Yahan sirf mammals nahi hai. In Chordata, you'll see fish also have this backbone thing. Fish are also part of Chordata, right? Under this we have, within Chordata we'll have many classes, and one of the classes Mammalia. We are mammals. So in Mammalia we'll not have fish, we'll not have birds, we'll not have reptiles, we'll not have amphibians, we'll only have mammals. So us, dogs, cats, buffaloes, मैमल्स सोचो, जो भी मैमल्स हो सकते हैं वो सब होंगे। एक मैमल्स हु डू नॉट गिव लाइफ बर्थ, हु गिव एग्स, ऑल दोज मैमल्स वुड बी पार्ट ऑफ दिस क्लास। नाउ अंडर क्लास वी हैव ऑर्डर, अंडर क्लास वी हैव ऑर्डर एंड ह्यूमन बींग्स कम इन प्राइमेट्स वाला ऑर्डर। तो नाउ हेयर ऑल डॉग्स एलिफेंट्स ऑल आर गॉन, ओनली प्राइमेट्स वुड बी देयर। जो बंदर जैसे स्पीसीज हैं दे आर पार्ट ऑफ प्राइमेट्स। अंडर प्राइमेट्स वी हैव होमिनिड, अंडर ह्यूमिनिड वी हैव होमोजीनस एंड अंडर होमो वी हैव होमोसेपियंस। इनफैक्ट ऑफ होमोजीनस ओनली वन स्पीसीज देयर, होमोसेपियंस। ऑल अदर स्पीसीज ऑफ होमोजीनस आर डेड। That's not the case with all other genuses. In other genuses, we'll see that there are many species available, but यहाँ पे ऐसा है। तो I'm going a bit slow because many of you do not come from science background and tend to find these terms difficult to understand. Please try to understand what we are trying to do in the all life forms. If I'm saying this is animal kingdom, even above it is life forms which have five kingdom. We are part of animal kingdom. Among animal kingdom, we are part of chordata. Among chordatas, we are part of mammalias. Among mammalias, we are part of primates. Among primates, we are part of hominids. Among hominids, we are part of homo genus. And then Homo sapiens. Now we will understand why evolution mein we are closer to bandars, primates, than to lions. We are closer to lions. Lions are also mammals. Than to fish. We are closer to fish because fish is also chordata. Than to insects. We are closer to insects than to plants or bacterias. Right? Bhavani has just written whale. Mere matlab motape pe mujhe whale bol raha hai, bol rahi hai, pata nahi. She has just written whale. Whale ka kya karun Bhavani? Like, is there a doubt? Whale is a mammal, yes, like, but is there a question there, Bhavani? भवानी चला गया। हाँ, इट वॉज एन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ मैमल, यस, वेल इज एन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ मैमल। ओके, सो आई होप एक ब्रॉडर अंडरस्टैंडिंग आया। आई शुड हैव टेकन दिस एज द फर्स्ट क्लास व्हेन वी स्टार्टेड बायोडाइवर्सिटी, सो दैट जब मैं मैमल्स, वर्टिब्रेट्स, इनवर्टिब्रेट्स, रेप्टाइल्स ये सब बोल रहा था, यू वुड हैव थॉट की विच पार्ट ऑफ द लाइफ फॉर्म वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट, बट आई एम होपिंग there is some clarity now. All the life forms on earth can be divided into two domains or two super kingdoms, prokaryotes, eukaryotes. Prokaryotes are those species which are having cells which do not have well defined organelles. So these are generally single celled species. Eukaryotes, cells which have well-defined organelles. They can be single cell, they can be multiple, multicellular. Okay, then these can be divided into kingdoms. For example, under prokaryotes, we have Monera. Some divide it into Monera and Archaea. Eukaryotes mein we have Protista, we have fungi, we have Animalia, we have Plantae. So animals, plants, fungi in the animal, plants, fungi and protista in the eukaryotic subdomain, a domain or superkingdom, and archaea and bacteria in this prokaryotic domain. All the life forms on earth, thoda clarity aaya hoga, I'm hoping. Now let's look at each of these kingdom in somewhat more detail. Monera. और यहाँ पे मैं बिकॉज आई एम गोइंग बाय द फाइव किंगडम वाला मेथड, आई एम नॉट गोइंग बाय द सेवन किंगडम वाला मेथड, तो हेयर व्हेन आई एम मीनिंग मोनेरा आई एम ऑल्सो इंक्लूडिंग बोथ मोनेरा एंड आर्किया. इन द सेवन किंगडम वाला मेथड वी हैव टू डिफरेंट किंगडम्स, नो मोनेरा एंड आर्किया, बट हेयर आई एम इंक्लूडिंग बोथ ऑफ देम टूगेदर. विल ब्रीफली एक्सप्लेन वॉट आर्कियाज आर. सो दीज आर प्रोकैरियोट्स, ऑल द प्रोकैरियोट्स आर इन दिस किंगडम, इन द मोनेरा किंगडम. So you may feel ki sir this is an extreme statement. Why are you saying that all prokaryotes are in the Monera kingdom? But it is, all prokaryotes are in the Monera kingdom. Right? Hum when we attempt preliminary examination ka question, we look at these extreme words and we say kuch to exception hoga. No, there is no exception. If you are a prokaryote, you are in Monera. Right? Then if you are prokaryote, you will not be multicellular. We already know that. We have studied that in science. Prokaryotes are always unicellular. They'll not have a body design as such. Ek single cell hi to hai. Then, even among prokaryotes, there would be diversity. Some prokaryotes will have cell walls. Some will not. Some prokaryotes will be autotrophic. Some will be heterotrophic. Autotrophic are those which will make their own food. Heterotrophic, which will depend on other living organisms for food. For example, we are heterotrophics. Human beings are heterotrophics. We depend on other plants and animals for our food. Whereas a mango tree is autotrophic. It uses sunlight to make its own food. Similarly, even among prokaryotes, there are autotrophics, there are heterotrophics. The most important example here are the bacteria. Bacteria are mostly unicellular and they are part of this Monera kingdom. Bacteria are in the Monera kingdom. Then some blue-green algae. Earlier this blue-green algae was classified with other algae, but these on the basis of their genes and everything has now been classified into Monera in cyanobacteria group. So it is considered bacterium, and the term algae is generally reserved for prokaryotic things. Algae, with the term algae is not used for there's a mistake here. It's considered a bacterium and the term algae is reserved for eukaryotic. Please correct it. Eukaryotic organisms only. Okay, come back to this. So algae, when we'll use the term algae, we'll generally refer to the eukaryotic algae. Here, even if they are autotrophic, we are calling them cyanobacteria rather than algae. Okay, please make this small correction. It should be eukaryotic. You can also understand. Wo read karne mein bhi aapko galat dikh raha hoga. Right. So this blue-green algae is also cyanobacteria, is also there. There are mycoplasma, anadena, some more examples of Monera. Itna yaad nahi bhi rakhoge, koi baat nahi. But know, clearly know that blue-green algae is part of Monera kingdom. Now, a important example of Monera which was in news recently, wo is spirulina. Spirulina is a blue-green algae. It was earlier classified with plants, with other algae, but now it is classified in Monera, which has a body composition which is very rich in protein. If you look at spirulina, you will see that it has 60-70% of protein. And thus, it is being used as superfood all over the world. Not only protein, you'll see, it has very good percentage of minerals, 6-9% of minerals, and thus is being used as superfood all over the world. Particularly B12, vegetarian food mein B12 nahi milta hai. Spirulina is rich in B12 also. And that's why it remains in news. Spirulina, which is being harvested from different places in the world, is being sold at very high prices. Can can play a very important role in challenging the or in dealing with the food security challenges that people are facing all over the world. This spirulina is in Monera kingdom. It's not a algae, it's a cyanobacterium. It's a blue-green algae which is in the Monera kingdom. If you'll go and search spirulina right now, you'll be able to find many newspaper articles talking about its nutritional features and its abilities to deal with the protein crisis and all those things. Even now, a lot of research is going. Some experts say that it may not be healthy for us. A lot of research is going, but composition nutrient wise, it is very rich. Okay, now come to the second kingdom. Achha, before going to second kingdom, Monera ko hum do mein divide kar lete hain, bacterias and archaea. So what is archaea? Archaeas are also prokaryotic. Inke bare mein briefly I have mentioned here. Archaeas are also prokaryotic. They are very rich. Almost 10% of the life form on earth are formed by archaea. Now they have cell walls present, they have membranes. This becomes important. How do they, from where do they get their food? They don't do photosynthesis, but using light, some of them are called halobacterium or phototrophs, using sediments, minerals available in soil, lithotrophs, using sulfur, organotrophs. So they can survive. These archaea can get foods from all these extreme sources. Matlab, just from soil they'll get their food, just from sulfur they'll get food, just from sunlight they'll be able to get energy. And thus many of them are also known as extremophiles. Extremophiles are those living organisms which can survive in very extremely difficult circumstances. For example, if you'll go to, let's say, a volcano, in that heat, will living organisms survive? Scientists have recently been finding, yes, extremophiles are able to survive even there. So what are extremophiles? Extremophiles are these archaea. They'll be able to survive in very salty waters. They'll be able to survive in a very hot or very cold environments. These are extremophiles. So, archaea mein agar aap wo division karoge, to you'll be able to get that. Okay, now let's go to our second kingdom, protista or protozoa. Always remember Plasmodium, the parasite which causes, or the not the plus the protozoa which causes the malaria disease, is in this kingdom. We'll look at there are some other things also. So it mostly consists of protozoa, unicellular algae, some multicellular algae are also present. Some scientists prefer to add multicellular algae in protozoa. Some say they should be included in plants, in plant kingdom. So we for now are including it here. Okay, algae are also, unicellular algae so definitely are here. All the unicellular eukaryotes, prokaryotes so are all unicellular, but they are in the Monera or the archaea wala kingdom. Unicellular eukaryotes, they would come here. But are all the living organisms in this kingdom unicellular? Not necessarily. Even multicellular algae are included here. So this is basically a hodgepodge category. I as I told you in the beginning, if you're not able to fit something in fungi, plant, animalia, put them in protozoa. If there's a eukaryotic organism, prokaryotic hai to protista mein chala jayega. If it's eukaryotic and if it's not satisfying the animal wala features or plants wala features or fungi wala features, it would go in this category. Now, see, mostly unicellular, but I have explained there are exceptions also. They can be autotrophic or heterotrophic. Autotrophic algae are autotrophic, heterotrophic amoeba amoeba was not producing its own food. It was taking food from out its environment. Then they primarily live in water. Some can live in a moist soil also. Some of these organisms use appendage to move around. This is called flagella. While speaking about cells, we had talked about flagella also. Right? There is only one type of cell in human beings which have flagella, the sperm cell. We had spoken about this also in our science and technology class. So examples are unicellular algae, diatoms, plasmodiums. These are all examples of this particular kingdom. Now, why is it important to study this? You have to understand that diatoms are those unicellular living or very small living organisms. Sometimes in 2014, there was a question on food chain. So, crustaceans diatom ko khayenge ya diatom crustaceans ko khayenge? You have to know this. So, we would see that crustaceans are much larger organisms. They'll consume diatoms. So, diatoms is mentioned here. So you have to know these things also ki kaun sa kingdom mein aata hai to logically solve certain questions. Now come to fungi. These are heterotrophic eukaryotic organisms who use decaying organic material for food and thus are also called saprophytes. They are heterotrophic eukaryotic. They do not make their own food. They are eukaryotic, dono cheeze. Now, they can become multicellular at some stage of life. So, because they can become multicellular, you would understand why they are not added in the first category. Then, they also have a feature that they all have cell walls made up of highly complex sugar called chitin. So mushroom is in this category, yeast is in this category. Yeast using which alcohol is made. Mushroom, all of us may have consumed mushroom. It is with fungi that cyanobacterium come in a mutual relationship to form lichens. We spoke about lichens. Well, in biodiversity we briefly talked about lichens also. So it was a mutually dependent relationship between fungi and blue-green algae. Blue-green algae is where? In the Monera category, Monera kingdom. Fungi in fungi here. Okay, then recent fungi which was in news was Kira jadi. Now what is this Kira jadi? It's a medicinal mushroom. Medicinal mushroom, this mushroom has a lot of medicinal properties. So traditional Asian medicines mein it's in use a lot, and because of its overuse it has become endangered in China. It's still not endangered in India, but people are collecting it and it's very expensive. Now, something special, why is it called Kira jadi? Kira, the word Kira comes from Kira, insects. Because it parasites on larva of ghost moth. Moth is an insect. On its larva, it will parasite. It will eat that larva and from there it will produce a fruiting body. And it is this fruiting body which will come out, which has this medicinal property. Kira jadi, kira, kira, jadi, jadi booty wala jadi. In Hindi we have the term jadi booty for medicines, no? So kira jadi. So this is a fungi which feeds on larva, which parasites on larva. Jaise plasmodium humare body mein aake parasite ban jata hai, waise it parasites on larva and produces this. Plants, all the plants. You may include multicellular algae in it, you may not include multicellular algae in it. See, yahan pe humne likha hai, algae are classified under Protista, but some biologists classify multicellular algae under Plantae. I've given you like the debate. They may be under, we in under Protista, we had included algae. We had said that Protista are mostly unicellular, but multicellular algae are also added in there. So what are the key characteristics for you to be included in this classification? First is, you should be autotroph. You should be making your own food and use chlorophyll for photosynthesis. Second is, you should have cell wall. You should have cell wall. So if you are doing photosynthesis, if you have proper cell walls, and we would see, because algae is a condition satisfy kar denge, but still they are not included. So you should have some other features also to be included under this category. Then animalia, multicellular eukaryotes without cell walls would be included. So we will talk about plant kingdom and animal kingdom in a lot more detail. That is our focus, that is our primary focus for today's class. Let us start with the plant kingdom. Let us start with animal kingdom. Okay, so we looked at five kingdoms broadly: Monera, Protista, the fungi, plant, and animals. So now we'll look at plants and animals in more detail. Let's start with animal kingdom. So animal kingdom may organisms which are eukaryotic, organisms which are multicellular, and organisms which are heterotrophic. They do not make their own food. They can further be classified into vertebrates and invertebrates. So vertebrates are those living organisms which have their own backbone. Like, look at me, I have a backbone. Look at fish, look at a dog, look at a bird. They have this backbone, and because of this, they have a proper structure. They'll have a true vertebral column and internal skeleton. This will allow, all this allows that in this column, different things could be attached in my body. Okay, now they are bilaterally symmetrical. Look at any vertebrate. If you'll split me from here, from between, you'll see that on both sides, symmetry is there. If you take a bird, split it. If you take a fish, split it. You'll see that they are bilaterally symmetrical. They are triploblastic. What is meant by they being triploblastic? In their embryonic stage, you'll see their cell layers are derived, they're derived from three kinds of cell layers: ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. Abhi hum triploblastic ko aur detail mein samjhenge. Okay, they are segmented, you understand, and they are also coilomic. What is meant by they being coilomic? Their body will have well-defined cavities where different organs would be there. Hamari body ke andar cavity hai, jahan pe you have heart, you have lungs, you have your stomach. All those organs are there. This is a feature. Vertebrates are mostly advanced organisms. So this is a feature of advanced organisms. They being triploblastic. There are biploblastic organisms also, but being triploblastic is a feature of vertebrates. Having this cavity inside your body in which different organs can independently grow, they are coilomic. Then they'll have complex differentiated differentiation of body tissues and organs. Ye toh common sense hai. Now look at these things in somewhat more detail. Vertebrates ko pehle samajhte hain before we go to invertebrates. So invertebrates, the first thing that we are looking at is fish. Now you will not find any fish species which is not living in water. Fish species are, they have to be aquatic. They are aquatic. Fish are cold blooded. Only you will see that only mammals and birds are warm blooded, others are cold blooded. Would someone tell me what is the meaning of something being cold blooded? Shivani has asked a question. सर हाउ कैन एनी प्रोकैरियोट सर्वाइव विदाउट सेल वॉल? वोंट द साइटो बेटा, सेल वॉल एंड सेल मेम्ब्रेन आर टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वी डू नॉट हैव सेल वॉल. ह्यूमंस डू नॉट हैव सेल वॉल्स. हमारे सेल्स में सेल वॉल नहीं होता. दे हैव सेल मेम्ब्रेन. इवन अबव सेल मेम्ब्रेन प्लांट्स हैव सेल वॉल्स. सो दीज आर टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स. ओके, हाँ. नाउ वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट कोल्ड ब्लडेड ऑर्गेनिजम्स. क्या होते हैं कोल्ड ब्लडेड लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स? आर दोज ऑर्गेनिजम्स विच कैन मॉडिफाई देयर बॉडी टेम्परेचर. वी डू नॉट. बताओ. बिकॉज दे रिड्यूस द टेम्परेचर. वो अपने बॉडी टेम्परेचर को एकदम कम कर लेते हैं ताकि एनर्जी की जरूरत ना पड़े, एनर्जी यूज ना हो रहा हो. कोल्ड ब्लडेड एनिमल्स, कोल्ड ब्लडेड ऑर्गेनिजम्स, दे वुड डू व्हाट? दे कैन चेंज देयर बॉडी टेम्परेचर. इफ दे विल नॉट फाइंड फूड, दे विल रिड्यूस देयर बॉडी टेम्परेचर टू वेरी लो लेवल सो दैट नॉट अ लॉट ऑफ एनर्जी इज कंज्यूम्ड एंड दे कैन सर्वाइव. वेयर एज अस ह्यूमन बींग्स, क्या हमें खाना नहीं मिलेगा तो हम अपना बॉडी टेम्परेचर कम करके, लाइक टू कीप आवर बॉडी टेम्परेचर 37 डिग्री सेल्सियस वी नीड एनर्जी. नो, इफ वी डू नॉट गेट फूड कैन वी रिड्यूस आवर बॉडी टेम्परेचर? नो, वी आर वार्म ब्लडेड. सो फिश इज कोल्ड ब्लडेड. फिश वुड ऑलवेज ब्रीद विथ गिल्स, इट विल नेवर हैव लंग्स. सो व्हेन ब्लू व्हेल हैज लंग्स, ब्लू व्हेल इज अ मैमल, इट्स नॉट अ फिश. फिश have scales and fish, fish would lay eggs, fish have two chambered heart, fish would have a muscular tail which will help in its movement. There are many kinds of fish. Some fish have skeletons made entirely of cartilage. We have already discussed the example of sharks. Shark skeleton is made up of cartilage. There are fish whose skeleton is made up of bones, and bones and shark together. Then there are amphibians. Amphibians, how do they differ from fish? एक तो एम्फीबियंस नीड नॉट बी कंप्लीटली एक्वाटिक, दे मे सर्वाइव ऑन बोथ द थिंग्स. देन दे लैक स्केल. फिश वुड हैव स्केल, दे वुड नॉट हैव स्केल. फिश हैव थ्री चेम्बर्ड, टू चेम्बर्ड हार्ट, दे हैव थ्री चेम्बर्ड हार्ट. बट दे आर ऑल्सो कोल्ड ब्लडेड, दे कैन लिव बोथ लैंड एंड वॉटर. दे हैव वेब्ड फीट, लुक एट दिस फीट. सो इन देयर फिंगर्स दे हैव दिस webbed kind of thing made which will help them in easy swimming. That is webbed feet. Like this, if I swim, I'll not be able to push a lot of water behind me because water will get out of this. But here, this feet which will have web kind of thing, it will be able to push a lot of water behind and thus its movement would be faster. So they have webbed feet. Amphibians have both lungs and gills, and that is why they can breathe. Turtles, they can survive inside the water and they can survive on the land. Frogs, they can survive inside the water, they can survive on the land because they have both lungs and gills. They'll have moist and smooth skin. They'll also have four legs and they will lay eggs. Reptiles. Reptiles are also cold-blooded. Abhi tak humne dekha fish, amphibians, reptiles. They're all cold-blooded. They have scales. They have dry skin. They'll usually lay egg with very tough covering. Then, ear holes they would have instead of ears. They'll have small ear holes there. Their hearts are generally three-chambered, but in some cases, for example, crocodile is also a reptile which has four-chambered heart. So, reptiles may we have snakes, turtles, lizards, crocodiles. We have discussed many examples of reptiles already. When we were dealing with critically endangered reptiles and so on. Okay, now birds are warm blooded. Birds would have features like they have feathers and they have wings, they lay eggs. Birds would have two legs. Have you ever seen birds jiske char legs ho? No. Birds would have two legs. They will not have ears, they'll have ear holes. They'll breathe through lungs and they also have four chambered hearts. All birds without exception. like human beings, have four chambered hearts. Then mammals. Mammals are also warm-blooded. Mammals also have hairs and fur. The skin has hairs as well as sweat and oil glands. Most give birth to live young. जैसे हमारे जो बच्चे पैदा, हम अंडा नहीं देते. We don't lay eggs. We give birth to live ones. There are some exceptions. For example, platypus and echidna. We have already studied this also when we were dealing with mammals. Exceptional mammal करके हमने second lecture में we had covered this. Other than these, mostly they give birth to young ones. Then a very important feature is they'll have mammary glands. Females would have mammary glands. This mammary glands would be used to produce milk through which they would nurse the child. This is an important feature of mammals. In fact, the term mammals, mammary gland, isse derive ho raha hai. You will not see other species wo apne bachchon ko doodh pila rahe ho. It's mammals which would do that. Be it bats, be it cat, be it cow, be it humans, be it buffalo, it would be mammals who would be doing it. And all mammals have four chambered hearts. So blue whale is a mammal, bat is a mammal, we are also mammals. Okay, now invertebrates. Now I'm getting into I'm talking about invertebrates as much as I'm talking about vertebrates, but thode se technical words hain, you can ignore it also. You can ignore it in the sense, if you are feeling that ha ye difficult ho raha hai, so don't worry. Chances of these details, vertebrates can be asked. They may ask you a question, all mammals have four chambered heart. They may ask you that question. Basic NCERT se question puche ja sakte hain, and these are the things that we have taken from NCERT. But invertebrates ke details mein jane ke chances kam hai, but still, because they are in NCERT, my responsibility is, in environment, biodiversity and climate change, you should not need to touch anything else other than our notes. So even NCERT karne ki zarurat na pade, the things which are relevant there, I'm trying to include them here only. Okay. So invertebrates are those animals, animal kingdom mein we divided animal kingdom into vertebrates and invertebrates, are those animals who do not have a backbone. Think of jellyfish. Jellyfish, does it have a backbone? No. Jellyfish would come here. So jellyfish is not actually a fish. Here you would understand. Because we have already seen features of fish. Fish would have a backbone. Fish is cold-blooded. Fish have scales. Those are the features there. Is jellyfish satisfying any of those features? No. But 98% of all living organisms are invertebrates. Very few of them, only 2% of the living, 98% of living organisms, 98% of all animals, I'm sorry, I made a mistake there. 98% of all animals, animal kingdom mein jo species hain, they are invertebrates. They do not have internal skeleton made up of bone. Many invertebrates have a fluid filled hydrostatic skeleton. So jellyfish ko dekh lo, they'll have a fluid filled hydrostatic thing. Some of them will have hard outer shell. For example, crabs and all, hard outer shell is also even insects, cockroach, fly, they'll have a hard outer shell and so on. So invertebrates are divided into further categorized into Porifera, Cnidaria, Platyhelminthes, Nematode, Annelids, Arthropods. Arthropods are important. Isko padhna, isko acche se samajhna. In arthropods, we'll have insects, crustacean, arachnids. Then we have mollusk, we have echinoderms, and we have protochordata. Protochordata basically, see, you must be knowing the word proto. Proto batata hai beginning. For example, when you study Neolithic sites, sites which just come before Neolithic are proto-Neolithic. हिस्टोरिक से पहले प्रोटो हिस्टोरिक। तो प्रोटो कॉर्डेटा, कॉर्डेटा क्या है, ये जिनके वो है बैकबोन है। तो दीज आर प्रोटो कॉर्डेटाज आर इनवर्टिब्रेट्स विच विल हैव सम काइंड ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर विच इज शोइंग अ ट्रांजिशन फ्रॉम इनवर्टिब्रेट्स टू वर्टिब्रेट्स। ओके, तो लेट्स लुक एट इट वंस। पोरीफेरा इज अ वेरी बेसिक वर्टिब्रेट। दीज आर स्मॉल ऑर्गेनिजम्स विच आर नॉट मोबाइल। इन एनिमल किंगडम नॉट एवरीथिंग मूव्स। दीज आर लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म विच आर नॉट मोबाइल। They'll get stuck to some other animals or plant and उन्हीं पे grow करेंगे, उन्हीं पे survive करेंगे, and they do not make their own food. That's why हम इन्हें plants वाले category में नहीं डाल सकते। They are eukaryotic. They are in the animal category. They are porifera. Now they have a lot of holes because they do not have a well-defined structure in their body. So how would water get transmitted throughout the body? How will nutrition get transmitted throughout the body? So because they have these lot of holes, through these holes water or nutrition gets transmitted throughout the body. They also have this hard outside layer which protects them. Body design minimal hai, like differentiation among organs and all is missing. So you'll see that very minimal differentiation and division of into tissues are there. It's difficult to identify ki ye heart hai, ye lungs hai. No, it would not come. See, you'll have heart, lungs, different organs once the body becomes, body has a cavity, coelomic, which was the case with vertebrates. Even in invertebrates, we'll go to some living organisms where, which are coelomic. That is, they have a cavity. So they are neither symmetrical, nor coelomic, nor tripoblastic. So they'll have a very simple body structure. Then we have cnidaria. Cnidaria live in water, and when compared to porifera, they have better body designs. They are made up of two layers of cell. If they were made up of three layers of cells, so we would have gone to tripoblastic wala thing. They're made up of two layers of cell. One layer of the cell forms the outside of the body. One layer of the cell forms the inner lining of the body. Some of them live in colonies. For example, corals. Corals come in cnidaria wale group mein. Some roam around individually, like hydra. This hydra given here. They are also in the cnidaria category. So corals, when you pick up a coral, do you find a well structure there? No. Do you find उसके अंदर कैविटी में ऑर्गन्स होंगे? नो, राइट। जेलीफिश इज ऑल्सो इन दिस कैटेगरी, इन द निडारिया कैटेगरी, नीचे से होके। तो जेलीफिश इज ऑल्सो इन दिस कैटेगरी। नाउ कम टू द थर्ड वन, प्लैटी हेलमिंथस। यहां पे आप देखोगे Platyhelminthes is becoming more complex than the porifera or cnidaria. Here you'll find bilateral symmetry. In vertebrates, that bilateral symmetry is there in everything. In invertebrates, as they are advancing, bilateral symmetric city is coming. They have three layers of cell and thus are triploblastic. So in the early stages they have three layers of cell jisse various tissues bante hain. Then even here the inner cavity is not there, that's why we'll not call it coelomic, and thus well defined organs would not be there even in this category. So flatworm, flukes, tapeworm, these are some examples here. Nematode more advanced than प्लैटीहेल्मिंथस। तो नेमेटोड में आप देखेंगे दे आर बाइलेटरली सिमेट्रिकल, दे आर ट्राइपोब्लास्टिक, दे हैव अ सिलिंड्रिकल बॉडी। सी इन दिस केस, इन द अर्लियर केस वी आर कॉलिंग इट फ्लैट वर्म बिकॉज ऑफ नॉट हैविंग एनी इंटरनल बॉडी कैविटी, दे वर अ बिट फ्लैट इन नेचर। वेयर इज इन दिस वन, इन नेमेटोड्स दे विल हैव अ सिलिंड्रिकल स्ट्रक्चर। इवन नाउ दे डू नॉट हैव वेल डिफाइंड ऑर्गन्स, बट they have some sort of cavity inside and therefore pseudo coelom hum inhe bolte hain, like the cavity is called pseudo coelom. These are very familiar parasites. For example, the filarial worm which causes elephantiasis disease. We have studied elephantiasis, jab pair aise bade ho jate hain tooth ke, it is caused by filarial worms or worms in the intestine, round worms. These are also in this particular kingdom nematodes. Then we have annelids. They are triploblastic, three layers of cell in the embryonic stage jisse body bana hoga. They are bilaterally symmetrical, look at them, they are bilaterally symmetrical, they are segmented and they are coelomate worm. That is, in there is cavity. Okay, advancement is taking place. Now they have an organ grade system. Coelomic jaise hi aap banoge, the cavity is available, after that you will find these organs coming into play, the specialized organs develop. Then we have arthropods. This is important, this is something that you should try to remember, this is something that you should study properly. And this is also the largest group of animals, arthropods. So when you look around you, the insects kind of things that you find, they're all arthropods, but insects are only one of the categories of arthropods. So let us understand first what are the broad features of arthropods before we go into further classification of arthropods. They have an open circulatory system. What is meant by open circulatory system? Do we have an open circulatory system? No, we have vessels through which blood flows, which takes various nutrients to different parts of the body. So we do not have an open circulatory system. But when you kill a mosquito or when you kill a fly, you would find that they did not have, or us waise nahi dekh paoge, generally a fly does not have a well defined vessel system through which this transfer takes place. उनके पूरी बॉडी में द फ्लूइड इज फिल्ड, सो दे हैव एन ओपन सर्कुलेटरी सिस्टम, सो द ब्लड डजंट फ्लो इन वेल डिफाइंड ब्लड वेसल्स, द कोलोमिक कैविटी इज ब्लड फिल्ड इन देयर होल बॉडी, इट विल द ब्लड फिल्ड वुड बी देयर. दे हैव जॉइंटेड लेग्स, जॉइंटेड लेग्स हेल्प देम इन मूवमेंट. दिस जॉइंटेड लेग थिंग वी हैवंट फाउंड इन एनी ऑफ द ऑर्गेनिजम्स येट, इट इज हेयर विच विल अलाउ easy movement. They also have an exoskeleton, outside skeleton which protects them, the outer covering here which protects these species. So cockroach, crab, butterfly, beetle, scorpion, shrimp, spider, lobster, lice, tick, termite, potato bugs, sea monkeys, all the insects you see around you are in the arthropod category. Now arthropods can be divided into insects, crustaceans and arachnids. What are these? Insects, let's first cover insects. Insects are the largest group of arthropods. They have three parts, their body have three parts: head, thorax and abdomen. So beetle, butterfly, moth, dragonfly, mosquito, they're all insects. Among arthropods, dekho, arthropods is basically talking about pods, legs. So insects, living organisms having legs, to us wale group mein hai. So fish would not be here. So fish to waise mammal hai, waise samjho. So these are insects. So crustaceans mostly live in ocean and other waters, they have a hard external shell. So crab, lobster, barnacle, they are having hard external shells, and they are included in the crustacean category. Then we have arachnids. Arachnids, spiders, ticks, scorpions, these we would group under arachnid. So ye arthropods ke andar insects, crustaceans, arachnids, this is the categorization. Now they have a special feature, arachnids. Unlike other arthropods, they would not have an antenna. What is an antenna? If you look at this organism, look at this, they have an antenna. Look at this ant ke yahan pe nose ke paas aap ek antenna dekh rahe ho, which would not be the case with arachnids, spider, ticks, or scorpions. Look at a spider here, you will not find an antenna. Scorpion, you will not find an antenna. So this is, most of the arthropods have antennas, but this don't have. Arachnids don't have it. Then we have mollusca. A name tells you that they'll have this mollusk kind of structure. So they'll have this hard outside shell. Barnacle, snail, squid, oyster, these are all grouped in the mollusca category. Now here the coelomic cavity is reduced a bit. There is very little segmentation. These are some basic features of mollusca. Then we have echinoderms. They are more advanced, and echinoderms have a specific feature. You'll see that from the center of their body there are radiating arms. So be it sea urchins you see here, be it starfish you see here, be it sand dollars you see here, be it ophura. Sea cucumber is slightly different, but yahan pe bhi aap dekhoge sea cucumber se aapko aisa lagega ki beech mein ek star hai, and from there the body is radiating. This is echinoderms. And finally we have protochordata. Protochordata kya hoga? Sometimes in their life they will be having a long rod like support structure, generally at the time of maturity only. So this is an informal category of animals which connect vertebrates and invertebrates. Ye backbone kind of thing would come into play here. Long rod kind of support would come into play here. Okay, in your notes I've given you some more things, read it. But agar man nahi hai invertebrates wale section ko acche se, itna zyada acche se karne ka, just go through the video once more and try to do this. Yes, it's echidna. I'm sorry, it's not echidna, it's echidna. Okay, now let's talk about floral diversity. Plant kingdom mein floral diversity. Ritu is typing, cold blooded animals body temperature varies with temperature. Yes, I also said that na, in cold blooded animals body temperature would vary with temperature. We are warm blooded, our body temperature have to be 37 degrees Celsius. If it goes down or if it goes up, it means we are not well, our health is not good. If it varies a lot, we die. Have you ever heard ki ek aadmi ko 108 degree ka bukhar tha? Nahi, 102, 103, 104, 105 isse zyada hua to wo aadmi nahi rahega, right? Avinash is saying, sir, cold blood cannot regulate their internal body temperature. Yes, see, regulation, dekho, we are regulating our body temperature, we are ensuring that it is 37 degree Celsius. In that way we are doing it. Cold blooded animals kya karte hain, wo outside temperature ke accordingly apna body temperature dhal lete hain. So we are regulating it at 37 degree Celsius, they are making it as per the outside environment so that they can survive in different conditions. स्नेक्स का आप देखोगे, बहुत सारे स्नेक्स जो बहुत कोल्ड एरियाज में रहते हैं, दे विल गो इनटू इन हाइबरनेशन मोड And when sun would rise again, and when ice would, snow would melt, they'll come out. They'll reduce their body temperature to very low level. Now you'll say, is that not regulation? When their body temperature is reduced to very low level, is that not regulation? Yes. We are ensuring that our body temperature remains 37 degrees Celsius. That is also regulation. But ability to increase body temperature, decrease body temperature, that's also regulation. Na? Mahesh is saying UPSC asked previous year question regarding cold blood. Okay, Mahesh. ठीक है, क्या बताएं फिर इसके बारे में? तमरीन सर, आई हैव अ डाउट इन मोनेरा, ओनली प्रोकैरियोट विल कम और यूकैरियोटिक कैन आल्सो कम? मोनेरा फर्स्ट वन ना? नहीं नहीं, मोनेरा वाज द फर्स्ट किंगडम, ओनली प्रोकैरियोट्स वुड बी देयर बेटा. मोनेरा इज प्रोकैरियोट, मोनेरा इज सिंगल सेल ऑलवेज. तमरीन मोनेरा हैज टू बी प्रोकैरियोटिक ओनली. देखो ना आप, फिर मोनेरा पे ही फंस गई, उसके ऊपर के भी सुपर किंगडम में जाओ. व्हाट इज द सुपर किंगडम? प्रोकैरियोट्स. यूकैरियोट कैन नॉट बी देयर. यूकैरियोट कैन नॉट बी देयर बिकॉज इट कम्स इनटू प्रोकैरियोट सुपर किंगडम. तो उसमें यूकैरियोट हो ही नहीं सकता मोनेरा में. मोनेरा आर्किया कम्स अंडर द प्रोकैरियोट सुपर किंगडम. Right, so it cannot get into the eukaryotic things. Okay, Samreen has also understood it. Let me see if there are other doubts also. Anurag is saying cannot sustain temperature variation. Who cannot sustain temperature variation? देखो, when you say that cold-blooded animals, Anurag is saying cold-blooded animals cannot sustain temperature variation. अब देखो, how did the tiger survive? Oh, sorry, not tiger. How did the snake survive when the temperature went very low? It reduced its body temperature and it went into hibernation. So it survived, right? So, Anurag got it. Okay. But हमें ले जाके बहुत ठंडे टेम्परेचर में छोड़ दो, वी परहैप्स वुड नॉट बी एबल टू सर्वाइव. अ वार्म ब्लडेड वन वुड नॉट बी एबल टू सर्वाइव बिकॉज वी हैव टू इंश्योर दैट वी गेट इनफ एनर्जी टू इंश्योर आवर बॉडी टेम्परेचर रिमेन्स एट 37 डिग्री सेल्सियस. एंड व्हेन वी आर इन अ वेरी कोल्ड एनवायरमेंट, हम इतना खाना नहीं खा सकते, इतनी एनर्जी जनरेट नहीं कर सकते, दैट वी even in that situation are able to keep our body temperature at 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, थोड़ा यहाँ पे बहुत सारे doubts आ रहे हैं. Cold blooded, warm blooded में थोड़ा और detail में पढ़ा देता हूँ next class में, क्या होता है cold blooded, warm blooded. But अभी समझो, मतलब हम warm blooded हैं, our body temperature, even if we are living in a outside temperature is minus 20 degrees Celsius, our body temperature have to be 37 degrees Celsius or something around that. That is not the case with a snake. It will reduce its body temperature, it will reduce its activity, it will go to hibernation. Ye chandni aa gayi sir, hibernation is a feature of warm blooded animals mainly. They do that because they are not able to adjust their body temperature. Nahi nahi beta, ulta ho raha hai. Theek hai, chalo I'll cover this in more detail, cold-blooded, warm-blooded thing in more detail in coming classes. In the next class only, at the beginning, I'll cover this topic of warm-blooded, cold-blooded in more detail. But hibernation is not a feature of warm-blooded animals. In fact, among mammals, very few animals are known to go into hibernation, and that's not real hibernation. For example, a bear. Bear is a mammal which goes into hibernation during winters after collecting a lot of food, but that's not real hibernation. Wo bas deep sleep mein jaate hain, that is not hibernation actually. Okay, isne Mowgli Wowgli movies zyada dekh ke dimag laga diya ki mammals are going into hibernation. No, sorry, mammals bol raha hu. Yes, mammals are going so that's not the case. Okay, bear actually goes into very deep sleep. It's not going into hibernation. bear's body temperature does not reduce drastically, which is the case with cold-blooded ones. Okay. Now, a floral diversity. अभी तक हमने वी सॉ एनिमल किंगडम इनवर्टिब्रेट्स वर्टिब्रेट्स इनवर्टिब्रेट्स वी स्टार्टेड विथ वेरी बेसिक एनिमल्स सो स्पंज लाइक एनिमल्स वी कम टू प्रोटोकॉर्डेटा एंड प्रोटोकॉर्डेटा से वी वेंट इनटू वर्टिब्रेट्स इनवर्टिब्रेट्स वी लुक्ड एट फाइव डिफरेंट फाइलम्स वेयर वी स्पोक अबाउट द मैमल्स बर्ड्स फिश एंड सो ऑन नाउ अमंग एनिमल्स How this classification is done. Animals may the most basic, plants may the most basic group is that of algae. I told you, algae can be included in plants ka definition also. Or the most basic group is that of thallophyta. Now, algae will not have a well differentiated body design. They'll not have a root, they'll not have leaves, they'll not have vessels, and mostly aquatic. So there are examples like Spirogyra, Eulothrix. So algae are generally considered, it is believed that they are amongst the first plant species, first autotrophic species that came on earth. They may have come. I should not say autotrophic. प्लांट्स में सबसे पहले एल्गी काइंड ऑफ लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म वुड हैव कम इनटू प्ले देन वी हैव ब्रायोफाइट्स प्लांट्स विच आर ब्रायोफाइट्स तो अनलाइक एल्गी दे हैव वेल डिफरेंशिएटेड बॉडी पार्ट्स फॉर एग्जांपल यू कैन सी लीव्स एंड स्टेम्स हियर इफ यू गो टू मॉसेस हियर दिस फिगर इज दैट ऑफ लाइव वॉट दिस मॉसेस विच ग्रो on the ground or on other plants wo green color ka covering jo ho jata hai there you will be able to see leaves so it would be there like they'll have well differentiated body parts but they do not have specialized tissue for conduction of water and other substances for example as we'll come to more complex plants we'll have xylem and phloem those specialized tissues which are used for transportation of water and all This would not be the case with these bryophytes. And they reproduce through spores. They would not have seeds. Aapne kabhi mosses mein seeds dekha hai? Nahi dekha. These are bryophytes. Now, if they do not have well-defined complex muscle system for, a complex tissue structure for transportation of water, How do water transportation take place? Water transportation does not take place within. They different body parts extract water from outside, from their environment. ऐसा नहीं होगा कि water जमीन से वो extract करेंगे and then it will be distributed, as is the case with more complex plants. Water would be extracted from nature by different players. Okay. Now, let's go to pteridophyte. From here, the vessels start. They are vascular plants. So, they will have vessels which will transfer water or other nutrients from one part of the body to another. So, they'll now also have well differentiated body parts there would be roots which will be getting water from the ground there'll be stem there will be leaves their reproduction is still through spores we have not come to seeds yet seed producing plants mein abhi tak hum nahi aaye hain so they do not produce seeds they do not produce flowers they are called cryptogams their seeds are not visible their seeds are not there we do not know how do they reproduce Okay, then club moss, lady fern, horsetail, these are some examples of pteridophyte. So, pteridophyte mein vessels aage. See, ek bar fir se shuru se kar jate hain. Thallophyte, they do not have anything. They don't have vessels, they don't have well-defined body parts. Okay, bryophytes will have some body parts, but they do not have vessels.
Okay, come now, we have body parts, we have vessels, but reproduction is not through seeds, reproduction is still through spores. Now we would come to that section where reproduction is through seeds. Those are called spermatophytes. Spermatophytes can be divided into two categories, gymnosperms and angiosperms. Gymnosperms are those plants which have seeds which are not enclosed in fruits or anything. So look at the cone. Ye cone dekhiye, seeds isme hai. It is not enclosed in some fruit. These are gymnosperm. Seed, they are seed producing, but unenclosed condition of their seeds are there. Seeds are unenclosed in fruit. Okay. Then we have angiosperms. Most of the plant species around us are angiosperms. So mango, apple, even the wheat, rice, all those things are angiosperms. They are the most diverse group of land plants. They produce through seeds. Even gymnosperms produce through seeds. They also produce through seeds. They do not produce through spores. They are vascular plants. They have well-defined vessels. They have well-defined body parts. These are the most advanced group of plants. Now, they can further be divided into two types based on the cotyledons that are present in the seed. So basically, what kind of plant you would be is there available in the seed itself. When the plant grows, the number of cots that you produce, for example, look at this beginning of the plant from the seed, look at this beginning of the plant from the seed. They have single cot or single embryonic leaf. These are called monocotyledons. They have two leaves at the beginning. Have you seen sprouting of plants from the ground? It is this phase that we are talking about. There, here we have two of these leaves. These are called dicots. There are clear differentiation between monocots and dicots. Monocots has one cotyledon, dicots have two cotyledon. If you look at their leaves of monocots have veins which are parallel, whereas leaves of dicots will be net-like, well distributed. In the same way, vascular bundles are complexly arranged in case of monocots, whereas vascular bundles, xylem, phloem ka jo bundle hoga, that will be arranged in a ring. Here, dekho, it's arranged in a more complex manner. The vessels are arranged in a more complex manner. Here, it's arranged in ring structure. Then, the roots of monocots are fibrous in nature, whereas they have a tap root. Wo structure mein differentiation aapko samajh mein aayega. The floral parts generally have they are in multiple of three. So, iske phool, the petals, there would be three petals or six petals or nine petals. Whereas, in case of dicots, floral parts usually have multiple of four. This, in terms of petals, they'll have multiple of four or five. So, this is angiosperm ka further classification into monocots and dicots. Okay, so with this, our basic NCERT wala part of classification of life forms is done. Sometimes UPSC ends up asking one or two questions from this section, and that is why I generally ask students to study it at their own. This time I have done it here just because some of you had requested it. Okay, this classification is summarized here. Plants which do not have differentiated body types, halophyte. Which have differentiated body fights, but body parts but do not have vessels, bryophytes. Which have vessels? Vessels may, the ones which produce through spores, reproduce through spores are pteridophytes. Uske baad, ones which produce through seeds are gymnosperms and angiosperms. Gymnosperms may, it is visible, seeds are visible, seeds are in the form of cone, एंजियोस्पर्म्स में सीड्स आर इनक्लोज्ड इन अ फ्रूट. देन इसमें भी वी हैव डाइकॉट्स एंड मोनोकॉट्स एंड द डिफरेंशिएटेड डिफरेंसेस बिटवीन डाइकॉट्स एंड मोनोकॉट्स वी हैव ऑलरेडी डन. तो दिस इज अ समरी चार्ट फॉर द प्लांट क्लासिफिकेशन. ओके, सो विद दिस वी आर डन फॉर टुडे. टुमारो विल बी डीलिंग विद इंटरनेशनल एफर्ट्स ऑफ बायोडाइवर्सिटी, तो रामसार ट्रीटी साइट्स, biodiversity, man and biosphere program, all those kind of things will be dealing with tomorrow. Okay, let me see if there are any doubts. Doubts वगैरह कुछ है नहीं, ठीक है. And this cold-blooded, warm-blooded thing, I'll go through it in a more systematic manner and कल की क्लास में दोबारा बताता हूँ. But please understand, those living organisms which are cold-blooded, when the temperature goes down, they would reduce their body temperature and they will go in a hibernation wala stage mein. Okay, chaliye, I'll see you tomorrow guys. Tomorrow I'll ensure that I also have an earphone that so that I'll be able to talk to you people. Okay, thank you very much.